Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our current affairs classes. So today you have 19th of March, and these lectures are basically useful for those students who are preparing for the civil services examination as well as other government competitive examinations, because you require to answer a few questions related to the daily current affairs. So for that you can study your daily national newspaper, any national newspaper, preferably the Hindu or Indian Express. Both of these newspapers are equally good. You can also supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures, which are uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis. All right. So you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube, that is Future IAS, and you will get the daily current affairs classes on the day-to-day basis. All right. So let's begin with the lecture. Okay. So first news is basically coming out related to the electoral bonds. Okay. So as you know that Finance Act 2017 has proposed these electoral bonds for the political funding. Okay. To remove certain anomalies which were there related to anonymous funding. Right. The electoral bond scheme was basically implemented by the government of India. But there are certain loopholes also related to this scheme that is called electoral bond scheme, right? And there is still, you know, the funding is going on to the political parties, which are again not transparent enough to call them as a some form of reform. So there is certain other reforms which are needed for, you know, in this electoral bond scheme. So what happens is recently an NGO which is known as the Association for Democratic Reform, okay, which have moved to the Supreme Court of India and basically pleaded before the Chief Justice of India to urgently hear the plea, okay, to stay the new set of electoral bonds which are going to be sold from 1st of April, right, this year itself. Now this NGO, which is known as Association for the Democratic Reforms, is pleading before the Honorable Chief Justice of India to stay on, you know, the selling of these electoral bonds, right? Because the crucial assembly elections like West Bengal and the Tamil Nadu is basically due, okay? Obviously, the Assam elections also due, but the crucial assembly elections belong to the West Bengal and the Tamil Nadu, specifically from the ruling party BJP point of view, okay? So the Association for the Democratic Reform basically moved in that, you know, background. Okay. Now the Reserve Bank of India as well as the Election Commission of India has already, informed the government of India as well as already put their apprehension regarding that these electoral bonds are basically misused. Okay. Now they have been misused and they become an avenue for the parking of some of the illicit money, right? Specifically for the shell corporations, okay? And even some proceeds of the bribe, right? Which are, you know, to be given to the political parties are also become the major avenues. So nowadays, the electoral bonds are basically used by the shell companies, right? Of those parent companies, basically to park their illicit funds, right? That is generated from the illicit business. Apart from that, you know, some sort of a bribery to the political party is also going on through these electoral bonds. Okay. So in that background, the Association for the Democratic Reform asked, right, the Supreme Court of India to stay on the selling of this fresh electoral bonds. Okay. Now the data which is obtained from RTI shows that, you know, this illegal sale window, okay, which have been opened in the past, right, have benefited several political party. Okay. Now there is a severe apprehension that this selling of the bond from April 1st would definitely benefit, right, specifically, you know, the ruling parties, right, before the state assembly elections, which are due in West Bengal, Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Assam, right, would further, you know, increases the chances of parking of this illegal and illicit funding, right, to the political parties through this shell company. So shell companies are behind of parking of all such, you know, illicit funding, right, in terms of the electoral bonds in favor of the political parties. Okay, now this electoral bond scheme have opened the door to the unlimited political donations, okay, even from the foreign companies. Okay, so that is, you know, legitimizing the electoral corruption in the country. So that electoral bond scheme has legitimized the electoral corruption, right, as a huge scale. Okay, and that too, you know, some sort of a transparency procedure is not there in this political funding. So there is non-transparency in the political funding at the electoral level. Okay, regarding background, the Finance Act 2017 basically introduced this electoral bond scheme, right, which basically exempted, right, the disclosure, right, with respect to the political parties under Representation of the People's Act 1951. Okay, so that allow if there is exemption, you know, from the disclosure under RTI Act 1951, obviously, right, there is a some sort of a, you know, the doors which are closed or simply, right, to the unknown funders, right, which will provide the funding to the political parties. So that is one form of the electoral corruption also. Okay, now the amendment also removed the cap that was there, 7.5% of the net profit in the last 3 years on the campaign donations. Okay, once you remove that cap that was there, now which have legalized again the anonymous donations, right, because now all companies will be, you know, can purchase these electoral bonds and they can park their illicit fund, they can bribe the political parties in terms of this anonymous donations. Okay, and even the donations which are received by the political parties, okay, they are exempted from the income tax. Okay, so they are exempted from the income tax also. Okay, not only about this, the Election Commission of India has already put the letter on, you know, on May 26, 2017. The RBI also sent a letter on 31st of January 2017, then 14th November 2017, 27th November 2017, which have already objected this scheme called electoral bond scheme, right? And which has already advised the government of India not to issue these electoral bonds, right, as a mode of, you know, the donation to the political parties. So this is what is something to be understood, that the Election Commission of India, as well as, you know, the Reserve Bank of India have already objected related to this scheme. Okay, next, road transport. Okay, what is road transport? As you know that it is a, you know, the mode to transport, you know, the goods and services as well as the people. So here what happens is the Union Road Minister or Union Road Transport Minister, the Nitin Gadkari, have basically informed the Lok Sabha that in 1 year or within 1 year, all toll collection or all toll booths which are you found basically while traveling, you know, on the national highways or state highways, so you will find basically the toll plazas. Okay, so Nitin Gadkari, who is basically the Union Road Transport and the Highway Minister, has informed the Lok Sabha that within 1 year, okay, all toll booths will be removed and these toll booths will be replaced by the GPS based toll collection system. Okay, so here the automatically the toll will be, you know, collected through the GPS based, you know, monitoring, and that will be, you know, that will not require any sort of a toll booths. Okay, so it will be the GPS based toll collection system, which means the toll or the toll tax will be collected, right, via GPS, right, the money will be automatically deducted, right. That will be based on the GPS imaging of the vehicles, as you know, the vehicles will be GPSly mapped, right, which will be mapped on the GPS as the vehicle move. Okay, so automatically with the particular vantage point, right, the money will be deducted from the vehicle. Okay, and Nitin Gadkari also informed that 93% of the vehicles are currently paying the toll tax using FASTag. That means this FASTag is basically for the seamless mobility, right, across the toll plazas, right? So it is a, you know, some sort of a, you know, the card which is being stick on the windshield of the card, and which is automatically been, the money will automatically been deducted. There is no need to purchase, you know, or no need to take, you know, that the, you know, the toll tax based on, you know, the physically, you know, giving the money to the persons who are concerned with sitting over their toll plazas. So 93% of the vehicles basically using or paying the toll tag using this FASTag, right? And remaining 7% still not adopted it despite of giving the double the toll tax. Okay. Now the government of India also adopted the vehicle scrapping policy. Okay. Under the vehicle scrapping policy, right, the fitness test will be compulsory. Okay. After the compulsory completion of the age of the vehicle, that is 20 years in case of privately owned vehicles. Okay. And if it is commercially owned vehicles, after 15 years, that means necessarily after 20 years in case of privately owned vehicles and necessarily after 15 years in case of commercially vehicles, a fitness test for the vehicle is mandatory. Okay. And this policy, basically, which is the vehicle scrapping policy, which was announced in the Union Budget 2021-22. Okay. And, according to which the automobile industry in the country will see a jump in the turnover of 10 lakh crore from the 4.5 lakh crore, right, in this policy. All right. Now, under the vehicle scrapping policy, okay, any vehicle that fails the fitness test, because necessarily after 20 years, or necessarily after 15 years in case of commercial vehicle, that fitness test will be conducted. If the vehicle is not fit enough, okay, the renewal of the registration of the particular certificate of the vehicle will not be issued, and that will be declared the end of the life of the vehicle. Okay, so the policy will kick in, okay, the government vehicle from April 1, 2022. Okay. So here the mandatory fitness test, first of all, will be, you know, done on, you know, basically on the government vehicles from April 1, 2022. Then the mandatory fitness test will be done for the heavy commercial vehicles. Okay. That will be mandatory, will be starting from April 1, 2023. And for other remaining categories of the vehicles, or including the personal vehicles, the mandatory fitness test will be done from June 1, 2024. Okay, so he is our union, you know, road transport and highway minister, Nitin Gadkari. Okay, next, the insurance amendment bill 2021. Okay, so the Rajya Sabha has passed the insurance amendment bill 2021. The main purpose of the amending of the insurance act was basically, you know, to increase the foreign direct investment, right? That is called the FDI, that is FDI limit. Okay. So the main purpose of Insurance Amendment Bill 2021 is to amend the Insurance Act 1938, as well as to increase the maximum limit of the FDI or foreign investment, which was allowed in the insurance company, right? Which was previously allowed 49%. Now this will be up to 74%. Now this limit, okay, would have, or this limit has increased to, you know, to basically, you know, 74%. Okay, so here, you know, that limit would be increased. So the bill basically, you know, try to amend this Insurance Act 1935. Okay, that will be, you know, increasing the maximum limit, right? The maximum limit for allowance of, you know, the foreign direct investment in any insurance company from 49% to 74%. Okay, the next act provide the framework for the functioning of insurance business also. Okay, because this act, which is Insurance Act, obviously, right, the main purpose is to basically for insurance business, and that basically also explain the relationship between the insurer, okay, the policy holders, its shareholders, as well as the regulator. The regulatory body of the insurance related work is basically the Insurance Regulatory and the Development Authority of India. Okay. Regarding the changes or regarding the amendment this bill is going to make, is that the act allow the investor to hold up to 49% of the capital in the Indian insurance company. That means beyond 49%, the foreign investors cannot hold, you know, the capital in any insurance, Indian insurance company. Okay. And that too, that must be owned and controlled by the Indian entity. Okay, now this is original act, that is Insurance Act, right? Insurance Act 90, you know, basically, you know, 38. Now, what has changed with this amendment bill? This has changed that the bill increases the limit on the foreign investment. The limit, instead of 49%, it has increased to 74%. And now this bill has removed this restriction, which was the owned and controlled by the Indian entity. Now there is no such limitation. Now it can be owned and controlled by the foreign entity also. Now previously, instead of you know, holding the compulsory from the Indian entity, now this limit has now removed. Now it can be held, or it can be owned, and it can be controlled by, you know, any foreign entity also. So this is what is something, you know, going to change, you know, in terms of the ownership and in terms of the controlling of such vehicles, such insurance companies. Okay, so this is what is the changes which is going to, you know, happen in the insurance bill. Okay, so which is something to be understood. Okay, the next changes which I've made under this bill is that any changes, right, or any such restriction which was removed related to ownership and the control, the central government will prescribe the additional conditions. So that is, the ownership of such one will be subjected to the conditions which are prescribed by, right, you know, the central government. This is what you must understand. Okay, next, as I told you, that what are the conditions? The act require the insurer to hold the minimum investment in the asset that would be sufficient to clear their insurance claim liabilities, right? So that is the first condition, right, that it should hold, right, you know, a minimum investment in the Indian assets, right, so that it, in the case of default, right, it is sufficient to clear all insurance claims liabilities with respect to the Indian citizens. Okay, if insurer is incorporated or domiciled outside India, that is, if he is residing outside India, such assets must be held in India in a trust or the vested with the trustees who must be the resident of India. So that means if a person who is having the ownership of, you know, that particular insurance company, right, or the insurer is basically, you know, domiciled outside the country, okay, such assets would be held in India because it is the Indian company in which the you know, the foreign insurer have the stake. So in India, the asset must be held in a trust or a group of trustees or vested with the trustees who should be the residents of India. Okay, previously the act also specify some sort of explanation, right, which will be applied to the insurer incorporated in India. That was 33% of the capital is owned by the investors domiciled outside India, and 33% of the members of the governing body of a particular insurance company should be domiciled outside India or are domiciled outside India. Now these conditions have now removed, right? So bill removed this explanation also. So a lot of changes have been done in this perspective also. Okay, so she is, you know, Honorable Finance Minister Srimati Nirmala Sitharaman. Okay, next, the supplementary demand for the grant. Now you must understand, there are a lot of demands which have been granted by the parliament. One such grant is supplementary grant. Okay, now you must understand, the constitution require that the parliament has the power to grant the, you know, the additional money, that is in the form of supplementary demand, you know, okay, for the grants to the government of India. Okay, now why this supplementary grant is given? So supplementary grant is given, right, if the government need an extra money, right, which is not been sufficient or which had not been approved by the parliament, right, for, you know, or which have need to be incurred the additional expenditure, okay, then it can brought, you know, such additional or such supplementary grant, supplementary, you know, demands for the grant. Okay, so this is what is something to be understood in terms of supplementary grant. So Lok Sabha has Thursday passed a supplementary demand for the grant that is second batch of 2020-21. Now, why this Lok Sabha? Because Lok Sabha has the only power to vote for the demand for the grant. Raj Sabha does not have the power. So this power is exclusively given to the Lok Sabha only. So that is why the Lok Sabha has passed the supplementary demand for the grant. Okay. As I told you that if the government need to spend additional money during the year, then government need to spend any money which have not been approved by the parliament earlier during the budget time, or it need the additional expenditure, then it can introduce this supplementary demand for the grant. And you must understand, they are passed right in every parliament sessions. Okay. Article 115 basically provides the supplementary and additional or excess grants. Right. And you must understand that unlike the demand for the grant, which is presented with the budget, okay, this supplementary grant have never been scrutinized by the standing committees. Okay. The remaining one can be scrutinized by the standing committees, but this supplementary grant never been scrutinized by the standing committees. Okay. Next, the Teachers Education Institution. Okay. As you know, that is called Teachers Education Institution. Okay. So Azim Premji, who is basically, you know, the philanthropist and industrialist, the Azim Premji University released the first volume on the teachers and the teachers' education. Okay. So this Azim Premji University has brought this first volume on teachers and teachers' education. So it has explored the landscape of the teachers' education institutions, their conditions, okay, the corruptions in the private teachers' education institutions, the support system that is needed for the teachers, the problems the teachers which are facing, right, who are specifically, you know, working on the contractual basis. So for that purpose, right, this first volume have been published. Okay. Now let's understand what are the key findings of this first volume. So this first volume says that around 9 million teachers are basically in the schools, right? Around 1.5 million schools in the country. So in the 1.5 million schools, around 9 million teachers are working. Okay. Now this report, you know, emphasized on that the quality of education should be imparted for the aspiring teachers, right, is equally important, because without quality of education, the future teachers cannot become good. Of the 17,503 teachers education institutions, right, more than 90% are privately owned. So you can say only 10% are government owned. These 90% are privately owned standalone institutions, right, which are offering the single programs and which are located in certain geographies. Okay. Regarding the locational aspect of these teachers training institutions, the four states, Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, Maharashtra, and Tamil Nadu, these four states account for 54% of the teachers training, teachers educational institutions. Okay. And only 12 states or the union territory have at least one teachers education institutions in every district. So that means in terms of the availability of these teachers education institutions is also not sufficient. Now, this first volume of the report also tells us about the worrying in the level of corruption. So there is high level of corruption, right? Most of the some of the teachers education institutions are dysfunctioning. Okay. And they are working as a commercial shops, right, for making the money. Okay. And the volume also provide that the teachers educational institution also neglected the basic curricular requirement. Okay. The classes are neither conducted. Okay. They are neither conducted seriously or not taken seriously by the students. Okay. And despite of having the shortage of the attendance, okay, these teachers educational institutions allowed the teachers, right, allowed the basically students to appear for the examination. So this is again, you know, not following the regulations which are provided by the regulatory body. Okay. Next, the volume also provides the increasing of the contractual teachers, right? So these contractual teachers are recruited based on the contract, say for 6 months, 1 year, 2 years. So they are paid inadequate salaries, okay? And they are given inadequate or little or no benefit, compared to the regularized employment categories. Okay, this report also says that this practice of employing the teachers on the contract basis have caused the long term damage, right, to the teaching profession. Okay, which has affected the student learning in Pan India level also. Okay, next, the next news basically related to the teachers contesting elections. Okay, so this is the news which is flashing out. So what happens is the Kerala High Court, right, have stayed, right, the Section 2, Clause 4 of the Legislative Assembly, removal of the Disqualifications Act 1951, okay, which allowed the aided school teachers to become legislators. That means they can contest elections. Okay, so the Kerala High Court basically declared this provision unconstitutional. That means the Kerala High Court debarred or restricted the teachers from the aided schools from contesting the elections or engaging in the political party. Now, this decision of the Kerala High Court have been stayed by the Supreme Court of India, okay, which basically, barred the aided school teachers and non-teaching staff from contesting the assembly elections. Now, this is something which is to be understood. Now, this High Court, which was basically declaring this Section 2.4 of the Legislative Assembly, removal of the Disqualification Act 1951, unconstitutional, right, have now been stayed by the Honorable Supreme Court. Now, the petitioners who brought, in the High Court have challenged this 1951 law, by saying that, the participation of this aided school teachers and non-teaching staff, specifically the aided school, would affect the quality of the education, right? And they also argued that the Kerala government servant conduct rules, right? So this basically restrict or prohibit the government school teachers, okay, from taking part in the political activities, right? And this rule, which is brought by the Kerala government servant conduct rules, should also be applicable to the aided school teachers also. Okay, now the government, however, contended in the High Court, right, which clearly says that as per the government order which was issued in 1967, right, the teachers which are belonging to the aided schools, now they have right to contest or they participate in the political rights. Okay, so there is no rule or act which prohibits from participating in the political activities or contesting elections, right, which the teachers belong to the aided schools. Okay, next. The next is Pritzker Architecture Prize. So this Pritzker Architecture Prize is also considered, right, as equal to the Nobel Prize in the architecture. Okay, so this year, this prize is given annually to the live, architect, right? So this year, the French architects or two French architects, which is known as the Annie Lacation, and the second is Jean-Philippe Bessel. So Lacaton and Bessel, both are involved, right? Or both are the founder of the French studio Lacation and Bessel. So the Lacaton and the Bessel, which is, the French architects, have been selected for this year, the Pritzker Architecture Prize for 2021. Okay. Now, these French architects, Lacaton and the Bessels, have been named as the winners of this Pritzker Architecture Prize. Okay. So that basically, their work basically reflect the architecture's democratic spirit, as well as their commitment to have the restorative architecture in the country as well as in the world. Okay, and it also marked the first time that a French female architect have won the Pritzker Architecture Prize, right? And the Lacaton, who is, a female, have been selected, and she is the sixth woman to receive this award, since the award was basically constituted in 1979 onwards. Since then, every year this award is basically given. Okay, so this year the two French architects, the Lacaton and the Bessel, have been you know, given this award. Regarding the information regarding Pritzker Architecture Award, this Pritzker Architecture Award is, you know, awarded annually to honor a living architect. This award was founded by, you know, by J.A. Pritzker and his wife Cindy in 1979. And this award is funded by the Pritzker family, okay, and it is sponsored by the Hayat Foundation, okay. And this award is considered as one of the world premier architectural prizes, okay, specifically in the architecture field. So it is also referred the Nobel Prize of Architecture also, okay. So this is basically very important for this one, okay. So you can see the Lekater and your Bessel who have been selected for this year Pritzker Prize 2021. Next, the John Magufuli, right? The John Magufuli was basically the president of, you know, the Tanzania. So what happens is the president of Tanzania died suddenly. Okay. He was also considered as an authoritarian leader. So Tanzania is basically mourning over the death of its president, the John Magufuli, right? The John Pombe Joseph Magufuli was born in 1959 and he died in 2021, right? He was a Tanzanian politician, right? Who's basically serving as a fifth president of Tanzania from 2015 onward till its death in 2021, okay? And the Magufuli was basically known specifically in this COVID-19 pandemic to, you know, to promote the misinformation about the COVID-19 pandemic, okay, specifically over Tanzania. And he was basically have some problems related to the heart issues as stated by the government. Regarding the country Tanzania, the Tanzania is an African country, specifically in the East Africa, okay, and it is located within the African Great Lakes region. Okay, regarding its political boundary, it borders Uganda to the north, okay, Kenya to the northeast, Comoro Islands and Indian Ocean region to the east, okay, Mozambique and Malawi to the south, Zambia to the southwest, Rwanda, Burundi and Democratic Republic of Congo to the west. Okay, the Africa's highest mountain, which is the Mount Kilimanjaro, is also located in the Tanzania. And Dodoma is basically capital of the Tanzania. Okay, so here you can see the political map of Tanzania, the neighboring country Kenya, Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, Zambia, Malawi, Mozambique, Democratic Republic of Congo, and the, you know, eastern side is basically facing with, you know, the Indian Ocean region also. Next, the Bihar Lokayukta Amendment Bill 2021. Now, as you know, that Lokayukta is also called Ombudsman, right? So Ombudsman is set up in almost every states, right, to inquire, right, related to, you know, the allegations related to the corruption against the public servants, right? So what happens is, you know, this Lokayukta is basically, you know, required to conduct an inquiry against, you know, the allegations which have been, you know, brought by, you know, some sort of a complaint against such public servant, right? Now, what happens is there were a lot of frivolous complaints, lot of false complaints which are filed in the office of the Ombudsman or the Lokayukta, right, against the public servant. Now, what happens is this tarnish the images of, the honest public servants sometime, because the image lost is lost forever. So the Bihar Assembly to control such false practices of filing the false cases before the anti-corruption ombudsman body, the Bihar Assembly passed a Bihar Lokayukta Amendment Bill 2021. Okay, this Bihar Lokayukta Amendment Bill 2021 basically proposes to punish the person which files the false cases before the Lokayukta against any honest person or any honest civil servant or public servant, okay? Because obviously the ombudsman, you know, it puts lot of effort and the time, right, for basically investigation. So it prevents the wastage of the time and misuse of the institutions, specifically for the political regions. Okay, so Lokayukta is, you know, required to conduct an expeditious investigation and the prosecution related to the allegations, right, of the corruptions against such public servant. Okay, now this proposed legislation have brought, you know, the changes in this law and to prevent the misuse of the Lokayukta institutions, specifically for the political regions. Okay, now this move was itself proposed by the Lokayukta itself, specifically to punish the people who basically, you know, brought the false cases before it. Okay, and already the Lokayukta acts in certain states have already the provision of the punitive action against such erring persons also. The salient features related to the Lokayukta Amendment Bill, which is passed by the Bihar Legislative Assembly. Okay, so the bill basically proposed a case against the person who files the wrong complaint. Okay, can be filed in a district court, right? And if the person is found guilty of, you know, filing a false case in the institutions of Lokayukta, right, then he will be sentenced to the jail term up to the 3 years. Right. Besides, he will also be, you know, a fine, or there will be also a provision for the fine also. Next, the valence seats of the political parties. Now, what happens is, again, the NGO, which is known as the Association for the Democratic Reform, right, have brought a report, right, in which report he had the NGO, which is called Association for the Democratic Reform, has brought, you know, a report which shows the balance sheet of the political party. So in the balance sheets, the Bharatiya Janata Party or BJP tops, right, in the declared assets. So out of 100% of the assets which are declared by the seven national parties for 2018-2019, 54% of such declared assets belonging to the Bharatiya Janata Party, okay, all assets. And regarding all liabilities, Congress accounted for the highest number of liabilities, that is 58% of all liabilities belonging to the Congress. Okay. Next, the Association for the Democratic Reform analysis also analyzed the balance sheets of the national parties, remaining national parties, for example, the BJP, Congress, Bahujan Samaj Party, Communist Party of India, the Communist Party of India, Marxist, and All India Trinamool Congress. That shows the combined total assets of 5,349.25 crore rupees. Now, out of this 5,349.25 crore rupees, 54% of this total assets belonging to the BJP alone, right? That is around 2,904.18 crore is basically belonging to the BJP itself. Next, the 41 regional parties, which are basically working in the states, which are also being, you know, compiled, the data related to the assets also being compiled by the Association for the Democratic Reform. Now, this regional party have the combined asset of 2023 crore rupees. Okay, so that was the data which was given regarding the asset and liabilities regarding the national parties as well as your regional parties. That's all for the today. So thank you very much. We will meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you very much for attending this session.